A word of warning to the wise. And of course, within the context of today's sermon, maybe a word of warning to the foolish as well, but you'll come across that a little later on. What I'm using today is the remedy. This is a New Testament paraphrase. In other words, there is nothing new doctrinally in what I'm going to share with you. In essence, there is nothing new in our understanding of events around the return of Christ and the lead up to those events. But there are possibly some new words, some slightly different ways. For those of you who are attuned to the KJV or the NKJV or whatever Bible you use, hopefully that change of word or words will not jar on you, but that you will gain some insights in what I have to share with you. So to start off with, I'd ask you to turn in your Bibles to Revelation chapter 22, and we're going to read verses 7 through to 16, Revelation chapter 22. And in my inimitable way, I like to start at the end of things and possibly just work back to the front. Revelation chapter 22, verses 7 to 16, reading, as I say, from the Remedy paraphrase of the New Testament. Understand this. I am coming back soon. Those who follow the prophetic truths of this book will find happiness. I, John, am the one who heard and saw all these things. And when I had seen and heard them, I was so overwhelmed with awe that I fell down to give honour to the angel who had shown them to me. But he stopped me, saying, "Don't honour me. I am a fellow worker of God's, along with you and your brothers and sisters, the prophetic spokesperson, and all who follow the prophetic truths of this book. Give honour to God and worship him." Then he instructed me, "Do not keep the message of this prophetic book a secret, for the time when these events will begin to happen is near." Now, just a slight editorial remark here. We remember that it is almost 2,000 years since John wrote these words under divine inspiration. So we have to be very careful in what we think the word soon, quickly, near really means. At its most basic concept, the promise is always to us individually that God is very near to us. But this hope that sustains us is that hope that Jesus himself will return soon. Do not keep the message of this prophetic book a secret, for the time when these events will begin to happen is near. Let those who harden their hearts in selfishness continue to be selfish. Let those who turn their characters on lies continue to be liars. Let those who have chosen to be healed to righteousness and loving characters continue to be righteous and loving. And let those who are truthful continue to be truthful. Then John quotes Jesus himself. Understand this, I am coming back soon to my reward is with me, and I will give to everyone exactly what they have chosen. I am the origin and summation, the beginning and the end. Happy are those who have their characters cleansed and minds healed, for they will have access to the tree of life and will enter through the gates into the city. Outside are the scavengers, those who practice mysticism and magic that confuses the mind, the hedonists, those who use power to hurt and destroy others, those who worship gods, who punish and must be appeased, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to give this testimony for the churches. I am the creator and the root from which life originates, but also the descendant of David and the true light bearer, the bright and morning star of truth. That, in essence, sets the groundwork. What I want to share with you ought best to be understood in this time when Jesus Christ himself will return. Most of us are reasonably well aware of what we anticipate. And I guess what I'm wanting to share with you is some of the sense of urgency that even 2,000 years ago, people like John and Jesus tried to inject into the presentation of the gospel. Turn to Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24, reading verse 44. So you too must keep alert. Stay aware and be ready, because the Son of Man will return at a time when he is least expected. While Jesus is saying it'll happen at a time when you least expect it, that doesn't negate the hope that you should have. It is a hope based on an awareness of his abiding presence with you, but we are looking beyond Jesus in our lives, but Jesus coming back, the creator of this world, the saviour of this world, to bring this world back into the reality that it once had in the Garden of Eden. He warns you that this will happen when you least expect it. So the obvious implication, maintain your faith. 1 Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. And I'm going to read verse 2. You find that we start at verse 3 up on the screen there, but I just want to use verse 2. Because you already know that the date and time of his return are unknown and will come like a thief, when not expected, when people are saying, everything is finally calm, we are safe, then events will unravel and destruction will come. It will come like labour pains to a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. Verse 6. So don't be like those who sleep, hypnotized by the routines of this world, unaware of the eternal realities of God's kingdom of love, but be alert, clear-minded, and self-controlled. In the book of Revelation, there are seven messages to the seven churches generally found around Asia Minor, Western Turkey, in around that area, but they are messages that the church over the centuries, since God gave these messages to John to pass on, these have been applied at different times by the church to how it sees its own situation. Initially, I'm going to look at Revelation chapter 2, and I want to share with you verses 5 and 16. Revelation chapter 2, 5 and 16. I implore you, remember the pinnacle of purity from which you have fallen. Turn back to your first love and practice again the methods that you did then. If you do not turn back, the light of truth will be lost to you and your minds will be darkened. Verse 16, reject these falsehoods and return to my methods. Otherwise, I will come and fight against these distortions with the sword of truth spoken from my mouth. Go to Revelation chapter 3 and verse 11. A repetition of the warning that Jesus has already given. I am returning soon. Hold on to the remedy you have received, and no one will trick you out of eternal life. Now, it's not without reason that the author of this paraphrase called his book The Remedy. It's built around the problem of disease and how disease is healed. And he uses these terms right through this paraphrase of terms that we're familiar with when we go to talk to our doctor and things like this. So the remedy, in essence, is how God gives us a prescription for spiritual health. And so we grow in grace as we keep taking our daily measure of medicine. Luke chapter 12, verses 35 and 36. Verse 35 in Luke 12. Be dressed and prepared to serve. No matter how close time gets to the end, this admonition from Luke is always pertinent. Be dressed. Ensure that your righteousness, your standing with God, is of such an order that you indeed can serve those people that you come in contact with, members of your family, the local church that you belong to, all of the world around you, regardless of where you find them, in church, out of church, you're being called to have such an effective relationship with God that you do serve. Jesus himself said, I came not to be served, but to serve. And that is the motivating attitude of the Christian. Keep your minds alert and your hearts burning with the desire to help. Like people eagerly anticipating their Lord's return from a wedding reception, who when he knocks, they instantly open the door for him. And many of the door knocks that come into our lives are in essence people coming to us, searching for the truth, searching for the love of God. Turn again to Revelation chapter 16 this time. Revelation chapter 16 and verse 15. And this repeats a thought that we've expressed earlier. Understand this. To the unhealed, my coming will be unexpected, like that of a thief. But the healed, who have guarded their hearts and kept their characters pure, will be happy at my coming and will not be shamed by the exposure of any unhealed character. And then in chapter 22 of Revelation, and looking at verse 20, Jesus, who gives this testimony, says, "It is absolutely certain I am coming soon." Amen. Come so, Lord Jesus. Come soon. That is our hope. Matthew chapter 25. And we'll be reading from verse 1 to verse 13. Matthew 25, verses 1 through to 13. Again, a very familiar section of the New Testament. But I like the phrasing in this. At that time, now the writer has a very clear understanding of when he's talking about. At that time in Earth's history, God's people on earth will be like 10 undefiled bridesmaids who took their lamps and went out into the dark world to meet the bridegroom. While all 10, now take note of what is being said here, while all 10 were sincere students of the word, only 5 were wise. The other 5 were foolish. The 5 foolish went out into the dark world with their lamps of God's word, but they didn't fill themselves with the oil of the Holy Spirit. This interrelationship, this necessarily interrelationship between the word of God and the Spirit of God. The wise, however, not only carried their lamps of God's word, but also filled the jars of their hearts with the Holy Spirit. Now I want to repeat, verses 5 and 6. Yes, okay, we'll touch on verses 5 and 6. The bridegroom took much longer in coming than they expected, and all 10 bridesmaids became drowsy and fell asleep. Now you remember this distinction that has been made. The difference between the wise and the foolish has to do with their relationship with the Spirit. But here Jesus is saying, but they all felt drowsy and fell asleep. In the middle of the night, that darkest period in Earth's history, as one writer has said, in the middle of the night, a loud cry was heard. The bridegroom is here. Come and meet him. This becomes a parable that is relating to the second advent of Jesus Christ. All 10 bridesmaids awoke and started to prepare their lanterns to shine brightly. But the foolish ones realized they could not prepare without the oil of the Holy Spirit. Note that they were caught by surprise. They were caught by surprise because fairly obviously, while they were students of the word, they hadn't learnt everything that the Bible taught them. Yes, they could not know precisely how long would be this delay, but they could be prepared. They looked to the 5 wise ones and said, give us some of your oil. Our light is going out. But the five wise said, we can't. A salutary warning. You cannot rely on anybody else's spiritual experience to somehow make up for your own lack. We can't. The oil of the Spirit that enables us to shine brightly is only provided in a sufficient quantity for each lamp. You must go to the source yourselves and get your own supply. Now, it needs to probably be said here that maybe what the wise were saying, you actually should have done that a lot earlier. But, okay, see what happens when you go and search for some of the Spirit. While the foolish ones were out searching for oil, the bridegroom arrived. The five bridesmaids who were prepared went into the reception with him, and the door was closed tightly. Are you satisfied with the best of your intentions as far as your spiritual well-being is concerned? Pray about it. Later, the foolish ones came, banging on the door, shouting, Master, let us in. Were they indeed saying, we deserve to be let in. We've done this, we've done that. But he replied, the truth is, you're not my friends. I don't know you. So, says Jesus in summary, stay alert, be vigilant, because you don't know when the Lord will return. Matthew chapter 7. Now, what I've done over the next three verses is look at some of this wise and foolish aspect of the Christian walk. Matthew chapter 7. This comes at the close of the Sermon on the Mount. And it again is a very pertinent warning to each and every one of us. Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 to 27. So, understand this. Now, as I've said, this is at the close of the Sermon on the Mount. Those who hear the truth I speak and apply it to their lives are like the wise person who built their house upon a solid rock foundation. Then, when it rained and floodwaters rose and winds beat against that house, it did not fall because it stood upon solid rock. That rock is Jesus. But everyone who hears the truth I speak and does not apply it to their life is like the foolish person who built their house upon sand. And great was the fall thereof. Turn now to Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24, we're going to look at verses 40 to 42. And again, you'll see this division between the wise and the foolish. There will be two men working at their job. One will have taken the remedy and be ready to go to heaven. The other won't. Likewise, there will be women who work together. Some will have taken the remedy and be ready to go to heaven, while others will not. Therefore, stay vigilant. Don't become complacent, because you do not know the day your Lord will return. And then in chapter 25 of Matthew, verses 31 to 33, just a little bit further on from the parable of the virgins, 25 verses 31 to 33. When the Son of Man comes again, in his unveiled fiery glory, All his angels will be with him, and he will sit upon his throne in heavenly splendor. We know this is one of those final closing events, just simply because of that description there. In his unveiled fiery glory, all his angels with him, sitting upon his throne in heavenly splendor. All humanity will come before him, and he will separate the healed, those who have partaken of the remedy, from the unhealed, as easily as a shepherd separates sheep from goats. He will put the healed on his right and the unhealed on his left. Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3, we'll be reading from verse 14 through to 22. As you realise, this is a very significant message. This is the message to the church at Laodicea, the last of the seven churches, and Adventist commentators have often discussed the time setting for when this particular message did apply. Sometimes we concentrate on the time and maybe miss its significance right through Christian history, as indeed the other six churches are. But as it is the last, and its language indicates that essence of finality, and the point that I have picked up that I want to probably share with you: to the messenger to my children in the church in Laodicea write, this message is from Jesus, the consistent, reliable, faithful and true witness, who is the origin of God's creation. Now, this is where we start to use what he says as some sort of measuring stick. I know your choices. He knows the good choices you make. He knows the wrong choices you make. And this is the indictment. Now, this is an indictment labelled at this particular church. Yes, he has an answer to the indictment, but first and foremost he says, I know your choices. I know that you are neither hot, or as the writer puts here, that you are neither on fire with love, nor do you appear cold with selfishness. Now, it's fairly obvious that Jesus likes the people who are on fire with love. But what he's saying to this church is that somewhere along the line, you've missed the message. And indeed, as I guess a rounding condemnation, he says this: I wish you were either on fire for my kingdom or clearly opposed to it. Now, that clearly opposed to it, you know, when you make your choices, where you stand in God's sight. But because you are lukewarm, a lukewarm mix of cold hearts, practicing selfish methods, while appearing to be on fire for my kingdom, you misrepresent me and make me sick to my stomach. I am about to vomit you out. Now, I want to look... let me see. Can you go back just one section, please, Enrique, where I can get back to verse 15. Let's repeat this. I know your choices. I know that you are neither on fire with love, nor do you appear cold with selfishness. Now roll forward for me, please, Enrique. We'll have a look at verse 18. Now, starting at verse 17... You claim to be spiritually rich and full of heavenly treasure, thinking you have the truth and are in need of nothing. One of the great challenges that we have is to come to the point where we realise we don't have all of the blessings that God wants to shed abroad in our hearts. You think you have enough. It's a bit like an elder I know being asked to organise an offering to help us finish the church, some fundraising activities. And after a little while of hard prayer, thinking about this sort of thing, I said, no, that's not for me. It happens to us. Sometimes the task overwhelms us. And that is a measure of our relationship to God, that we don't allow him the opportunity to work through us. But you are so self-deceived that you don't realise you are devoid of my character of love. That is what we always fall short of. It's not necessarily our ability to preach or to teach or to raise money or whatever. But what we fall short in is Christ's character of love. Not my character of love, but Christ's character of love. You are decrepit, pathetic, bereft of true godliness, with minds so closed that you can't even comprehend truth. You stand naked and exposed. My prescription, says Jesus, for you is to exchange your corrupt motives for the gold of godly love purified through fiery trials. God loves us. We are encouraged to love God. We are encouraged to love our fellow human beings. But we seem to think that when we do some of these little things, that, yeah, that's a good demonstration of love. But you can't even comprehend truth. You stand naked and exposed. My prescription for you is to exchange your corrupt motives for the gold of godly love, the love that comes from God, shed abroad in our hearts through the Holy Spirit, purified through fiery trials. When you love, and this is true in the human realm as well, you quite often don't get treated the way you think a loving individual ought to be treated. This is part of those fiery trials. Jesus himself loved the whole world, but a significant portion of that world crucified him. So that you can be rich in what heaven values. Exchange your filthy, selfish characters for the perfect character of Christ, pure and white, so that you can cover the shame of your imperfection. And apply the salve of the Holy Spirit to your minds, so that you can see and understand the reality of your own condition and that of God's kingdom of love. You can see that at the end of time, humanity is split into two groups. We call them the wise and we call them the foolish. But part of the problem that I see in this message to Laodicea is that there are times when Jesus will look at the church and say, you are neither hot nor cold. So this is his admonition. And I just want to share with you very briefly, and Jenny, you may like to make your way back to the organ if you like, because we'll finish up with this. In the week of prayer that we held just recently on Thursday's reading, the opening sentence of that reading, whenever Christians remind themselves, I thought that was rather an interesting choice of words, remind themselves. I think quite often we don't allow the Holy Spirit to remind us of these things. Whenever Christians remind themselves of the biblical doctrine of justification by faith alone, people experience an awakening revival and reformation. An awakening, a revival, a reformation. Now, the doctrine of justification by faith alone simply talks about how you relate to Jesus and understand the love that motivated God to set in effect the plan of salvation. Didn't finish me reading. Oh, there we go. It's good to have prompters down here. It is those whom I love that I diagnose and provide these therapeutic interventions. So take ownership of yourselves. Turn away from destruction and apply the remedy. I am here now. I am here now. I am standing at the door to your hearts, knocking with truth and love. If any hear my voice and open their hearts, I will come in and commune with them and they with me. Everyone who prevails by completing the treatment and lives in harmony with my methods of love until the end will sit enthroned with me just as I overcame and sit enthroned with my Father. That is the glorious hope that is before us. Those whose minds are open to truth will understand what the Spirit reveals to the churches. This is the great hope of our lives, that it must be the breaking of the day. We can read the Bible. We can see that the things that are occurring around us, right around this planet, at this time, is indicated as we study your word. But that has happened before, possibly not as extensively as we see it today, but we are better informed of all the tsunamis and volcanoes, earthquakes, crime, etc., that happens right around the world. We can almost observe it happening as we sit at home and watch our televisions. But the word of warning still is, no matter how much we read these events and that we have this hope that Jesus himself will return soon, it is essentially true that we can miss out. We need to maintain an effective, loving relationship with our Lord and Saviour. And to this end, as we leave here today, as we fellowship one with another over at our soup and buns, that we can encourage one another to keep ready, to be ready for the return of our Lord and Saviour. Please bless us to this end, for Christ's sake. Amen.